Your rabbi spoke with us, coming from Isaiah 58, allowed us to see, and I can speak for myself, allowed me to see that scripture in such a different light. And so I'm going to go from where she took us. I'm not going to go back over a whole lot, but I just want to take one portion and begin to look at, what is this? How important is this time? What is it supposed to do? What's the end goal? What are we supposed to get out of this time? And so let's go first to Isaiah 58. We're going to read just verse 6. To lay the foundation for just that. What is it that it's supposed to accomplish? What's supposed to happen? Now, because of the company that I'm in the midst of the people that I stand, I know that each and every one of us has gone over this chapter at least one time in this 24 hours. So I just want to pick this one verse to help us, and we'll go from there. And it reads, Isaiah 58 and 6, "Is this not the fast that I have chosen?" So right here, we're about to get some revelation directly from Yahweh as to why he chose this. In his words, to loosen the tight cords of wrongness, to undo the bands of the yoke, to exempt the oppressed, and to break off every yoke. Now, if we develop a new yoke between now and next year, we need to get that broken too. But what we do not need to do is to go Yom Kippur after Yom Kippur with the same yoke that he said, today, every yoke is to be broken.
Yes.
So I'm going to make it my business to make sure that I do my part. My part. And I'm going to be the example and pray that each and every one of you will do your part. Because we have a part in this. We have a part in this. Just a quick recap. We understand and know that the feast season begins with Passover. And we know at that time that we are commanded to cause the leaven to cease from our dwelling. That is something that we do. And everybody witnesses every year that we continue to have leaven even when we've done our diligence in trying to get rid of it. We know and see every single year, I can say since 2001, that every single year I've found leaven in some way. And even for the years that I did not believe that I found any and I finally thought I got it, well, last year trumped all of that because I found something that's been there the whole time. So what I know is I am insufficient in ridding myself of sin. That's the lesson that I get. I am insufficient in ridding myself of sin. That's my lesson. In the first set of feasts. Then we move to the middle feast, and what happens? Then we get a set of instructions. We get some guidelines. We get something to go by. The giving of the Torah happened at Shavuot. And not just the giving of the Torah, the giving of the understanding of Torah in the Holy Spirit, being that he who is there to walk us through, where Yeshua said, "I will not leave you orphans. I will not leave you fatherless." So he not only gives us his Torah, he gives us how to walk it out. And he gives that to us at the time of that middle feast. So here we find ourselves in the latter feast. And here at Yom Kippur, we ourselves cannot atone for our own sin. Biggest hint and clue to that is he never said, okay, cut your hand, spill the blood, and then wave that. He never told us to spill our own blood. Why? Because the blood that you that was required of you is the life that's in the blood. And that means that something dies. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. Now, with that said, now that you understand and know that we could not atone for ourselves, there were animals that were these placeholders. And we would sacrifice these animals. Why? Because that was a death. That's a death that is taking place. And that death now is accounted to us. Why? So that we can continue to live. And it should be that we now live and walk in the newness and renewedness of life. But here at Yom Kippur, we understand and know that Yahshua said he died once and for all, right? So in that, now he becomes that which atones for us. However, it was at Passover. He didn't die at Atonement. He died at Passover. That makes him our Passover lamb. He is the atoning sacrifice. But once a year, the high priest would do what? Enter into that place, into the holies of holies. And he would sprinkle the blood, and he himself would be in blood. So now let's begin to walk through some scripture. Let's first begin at Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. And we're going to start at verse 11. And we're going to read from 11 down to 17. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11 to 17. And again, keep in mind, Yahshua died at Passover as our Passover lamb. But he is also our high priest. So let's read. For both he who sets apart and those who are being set apart are all of one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I shall announce your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I shall sing praise to you. This is speaking, Yahshua speaking of Yahweh, saying that he would go amongst his people, his brothers, and he would announce the name of Yahweh in the midst of the brothers. Why? For an example. And he would also sing praises to Yahweh. Why? For an example. Right? So let's continue at verse 13. And again, I shall put my trust in you. And again, see, I and the children whom Elohim gave me. Now he's lumping us in. Therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself similarly shared in the same, so that by no means of his death he might destroy him having the power of death. That is the devil. And deliver those who thought who throughout life were held in slavery by fear of death. Why? Because there was absolutely no way to die and live again. That's why we killed an animal and not ourselves. There was no way to die for our sins and live again. So here, we were slave to that fear of death. Verse 16, for doubtless he does not take hold of messengers, but he does take hold of the seed of Abraham. He is including us in his resurrection from the death. 17, so in every way he had to be made like his brothers in order to become a compassionate and trustworthy high priest in matters related to Elohim, to make atonement for the sins of the people. And so, if you look at it, he's just like in John, where Yahshua is tying in Israel with himself and himself with the Father, and making, he said, make them one as we are one. And he's tying us all in. Right here in Hebrews, it's recognized that that oneness is in fact necessary for Yahshua to be a compassionate and trustworthy high priest. Why is that? Why is that? Well, the scripture tells us that he was tried by every trial that we are tried by, and that he was completely flesh and completely open and vulnerable, just as we are. So now he can be trustworthy. Why? Because we can say he had the same set of rules that I had, and he walked it out victoriously, so I can. And why is he compassionate? Because now we can say he understands where I am, because he's been there. I mean, how convincing would it be if I put my son in a basketball game against LeBron James? How convincing would it be? Not very. But if I gave my son the same opportunity to win that I gave the other person, I would put him up against another 9-year-old. That skill level is on the same level. And now there is equity. He did not make himself beyond the ability to sin, because then he would not be compassionate. He would not be able to understand. He would not be trustworthy in our eyes, because what do we say when somebody gives us advice and they haven't been where we are? You don't know what I'm going through. You can't explain to me how to blah, 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 because you don't know what it's like. Well, Hebrews 2 lets us know that Yahshua knows what it's like. Let's flip over to Exodus 25 and 17, and let's look at what happened with this atonement. And we're going to begin to really look a little deeper into the lid of atonement. We're going to go to Exodus chapter 25, verse 17. Exodus chapter 25, verse 17. And again, I want you to hold on to the fact that Yeshua died at Passover, but he is our atoning blood. I want you to keep that in your mind. We're going to come back to that. Exodus 25, verse 17 through 22. And you shall make a lid of atonement of clean gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide. And you shall make 2 cherubim of gold. Make them of beaten work at the 2 ends of the lid of atonement. And make 1 cherub at the one end, and the other cherub at the other end. Make the cherubim from the lid of atonement at its 2 ends. And the cherubim shall be spreading out their wings above, covering the lid of atonement with their wings. With their faces toward each other, the faces of the cherubim turn toward the lid of atonement. And you shall put the lid of atonement on top of the ark, and put into the ark the witness which I give you, and I shall meet with you there. And from above the lid of atonement, from between the 2 cherubim which are on the ark of the witness, I shall speak. I shall speak to you all that which I command you concerning the children of Israel. So let's take a look at this Kippur. This Kippur, this word Kippur, is H3725. H3725. And it means atonement. But what I really want to look at is the actual root of it, kafar, 3722. And in this, you can see it says to cover. It's the first thing, to cover, to purge, make an atonement, make reconciliation, cover over with pitch, to coat or to cover with pitch. And so right there, we begin to get a little bit different view. Let's consider something. We've talked about this before. The items in the Ark of the Witness were covered, but they were not removed. What does that mean? That means that the witness is still there. That's why it's the Ark of the Witness. And so you have now the witness. What is it witnessing? The items of rebellion. The bread is in there. What happened with the bread? They complained. The broken tablets pieces, the broken tablet pieces are there. What happened with the broken tablet pieces? They were dancing around a golden calf. The budded rod, what happened with the budded rod? They were complaining and saying that we can talk and Moshe and Aaron ain't all that. Yahweh speaks to us too, we're important. All three items, rebellion. But where is it? It's inside the ark. It's a witness to the rebellion. Let's think about this. Think about the positioning of the lid of atonement. Where was it? Covering that rebellion.
Thank you, Yahweh.
Yahshua is our covering.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Him atoning for us covers and holds in check that rebellion. The witness is still there. So that also means that our responsibility remains. Why? Because every now and then we like to go digging in our treasure chest and pulling that stuff out.
Yeah, that's true.
We like to sometimes even take the other approach, act like it ain't there. So when the going gets tough, that's the first thing that comes out of us. Because we've ignored it for so long. And we've pretended like it wasn't there anymore. But I can tell you, I'm not any kind of recovering addict or anything like that. But I have heard from many recovering addicts that they say the struggle never ends. And the second that they say, I am not an alcoholic, is the minute they'll find themselves back in there. The minute they say, I am not a drug addict, they'll find themselves back in there because they begin to ignore the problem. But as long as they know it's there and can keep it in check and do the things that are necessary to keep it in check, as long as Yahweh can speak to us, he speaks to us on top of that rebelliousness being contained. That's the picture I want you to get, is that the rebelliousness is contained. And that the voice of Yahweh and the instruction of Yahweh is on top and even has guards, standing guard with the two cherubim on both sides. And so we ourselves find ourselves sometimes going and removing the atonement to get to the rebellion.
Thank you, Yahweh.
We find ourselves removing the lid when Moshe did what? He sat on it.
Yes.
On it. So now you had pure gold that's holding it down. And the weight of the Torah, that who represents the Torah, sitting on it to hold it in check. To hold it in check. And so we talked, again, I brought up this idea that Yeshua died at Passover. So then how is it that he atones for us? I want you to turn really quickly to Revelation. And we're going to go to Revelation 19. And I'm just make these really quick points. And then there's something I want us to do. Make sure I'm in the right. Okay, so Revelation 19 and 15. Now, I apologize, I didn't put this on the screen. Revelation 19, 15, this is still coming up. Revelation 19, 15. Oh, now it's up. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall shepherd them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress of the fierceness of wrath of El Shaddai. Now let's go to Isaiah 63. Isaiah 63. And we've addressed this before, so some of you may be with me on this. Isaiah chapter 63. And we're going to read really quickly 2 through 6. Why is there red on your raiment and your garments like one who treads in the winepress? I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the peoples no one was with me. And I trod them down in my displeasure, and I trampled them in my wrath. That sounds familiar, right? Just read that in Revelation. Their blood is sprinkled upon my garments, and I have defiled all my raiment. That's why in Revelation he said my garment was dipped in blood, right? For a day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed has come. And I looked, but there was none helping, and I was astonished that there was none upholding. So my own arm saved for me, and my wrath upheld me. And I trod down peoples in my displeasure and made them drunk in my wrath and brought down their strength to the earth. Now, the priest goes into the set apart place. Yahshua is obviously the sacrifice for our atonement. It is obviously his blood that we need to atone, that his blood cleanses, right? But there's two sides to every coin. There's two sides. And so one side is he goes in, what? As the high priest. So that is the part that's not been fulfilled yet. He has not fulfilled the atonement where he as the sacrifice first. That's done. And next, as the priest, the high priest, who goes in to the holies of holies. This is probably a part of that picture. Because we're looking at, again, two sides of a coin. There is one side where his blood covers us and atones, and our sin is covered. There's another part where the blood of our enemies cover him, because he has trodden them down in his displeasure and in his anger and in his wrath for what they've done to his people. So that blood that covers his raiment when he goes in as the high priest to atone for us, that hasn't happened yet. We can see all the way up to Shavuot. We can see all the way up to Shavuot. But we know that the trumpet that we are still waiting to hear hasn't happened. And this atonement that we're waiting for has yet to come. But every year we're in practice. Why? Because what we don't want to be is the nations that he trods underfoot, that our blood covers his raiment.
That's right.
But in fact, we need his blood to cover us. And so how is it that his blood covers us and he becomes our atoning sacrifice? I'm going to write a few things up here. And I'm not going to do this in any particular order. And I want, matter of fact, here's what I would like. I'm not going to look at nobody. All I'm going to do is put a marker right there. And I'm going to start writing. And when you catch on, feel free to come up and write. We need Yeshua's blood to cover us and to free us. We need the lid of atonement to cover us and to keep us in line. This is our time, y'all. This is our time. It's our time to face what's in the witness, face what's under the lid. It's our time to recognize what's under the lid. And I'm not saying, and I'm going to say this real quick. Just because you write it up there, just because I wrote it up there, doesn't mean that this is your struggle. So you don't have to feel like you're exposing yourself to the community. But if you know that there is something that someone struggles with, it can be you, it can be your neighbor, it can be something that's in general. But we need to recognize what's under this lid. We need to recognize what's under the lid before we can make sure The atonement stays on top of it.
Forgive me, O Lord.
Hallelujah.
It's me again. I've disobeyed your word. I've slipped out of your bell. Remorseful I stand. Me again. I challenge you today.
With a sincere heart, lift your voices in request of the Lord.